So I'm here to talk about the governance for information technology and cyber weapons. And I think the first place to start is that information technology is a very, very, very broad term. So I'm really going to concentrate on what I'm going to call a cyber weapon. Information technology as such, it includes pencils and telephones and so on, and they can also be used for very bad things, but nobody's talking about dual-use controls or governance of pencils and telephones. So I'm going to think about cyber weapons, which I'm going to define as essentially IT, information technology artifacts that are used to affect other information technology systems in some negative way. Normally they either destroy or they spy on the information. The quick primer on that is that a cyber weapon has two parts. One part is a penetration part that allows you to get into the computer system that of interest, and the other is the payload part that tells you what you're going to do once you're inside it. And those two are very separate. The importance of that is clear when you think about a computer system, for example, controlling a centrifuge or a generator or something like that. It takes computer science type skills, hacking skills, to get in to the computer, but it takes knowledge of centrifuges and power plants and so on to screw around with the generator and the centrifuges on the inside. And I'm pleased to report that most hackers, computer hacker type people, don't know much about centrifuges or generators. So that's a big thing. Also important to note that cyber weapons may or may not be designed to be self-propagating. Sometimes, so you can loose a cyber weapon, and it can be very, very targeted and go after one target and one target alone, and it may appear on another system but not do any damage there. It could also be designed to try to do damage everywhere it winds up, and that's a design choice that you would make. The next part about cyber weapons is that the technology base for the penetration part, that's ubiquitous, right? You can find free hacking tutorials on the internet. You can order your laptops at Amazon or Dell or what have you, and of course the technology there is ubiquitous in the private sector. So the private sector is really what drives information technology advances, not the government in any way. Probably from my standpoint, the most interesting part about trying to get a handle on governing the cyber weapons is that there's no consensus at all that the use of cyber weapons is bad. That is, every nation doesn't want cyber weapons used on it, but every nation wants to be able to use cyber weapons on somebody else. We just don't know what we want. We don't know which is more important for us as a nation. We want both. We want to be able to do it to other people, to other nations, and we don't want them to do it to us. And they are, what that means, of course, is that when we do it to them, that use is good. And when they do it to us, that use is bad. And how you square, goodness and badness in that space is obviously not a question of technology. There's also the point that what you can do to with a cyber weapon is essentially infinitely scalable. That is, you can do nothing with a cyber weapon. That is, you can go inside, look around a little bit, and then just leave, and nothing happens, right? Your computer system has not been affected at all. Or you can go in and totally trash the system, and you can do many things in between. So the level of effect is scalable to anything that you want. So while most of us have not been the victim of a nuclear weapon or a biological weapon, all of us here, I'll bet, have been the victim of some cyber weapon at some point. Spam, for example. Everybody here has experienced spam, and that is in some way a cyber weapon. Why is it a weapon? Because it wastes your time. right? You have to delete it, and you know, you have to. It makes your system less available than it would otherwise be. The fact that you can scale it, you scale the effects to essentially anything you want, means that these weapons are, or these artifacts, these weapons are very usable, and that makes them highly desirable for policy purposes. If you think about the ways that you can that you might be able to govern cyber weapons, there are really three approaches to take. One is you might think about the acquisition of cyber weapons, that is, get acquiring the capability. The second is somehow regulating the use, and the third is somehow sort of confidence building measures or norms of behavior that say this is how you would behave in cyberspace. On the acquisition side of it, that's getting a handle on that, I will tell you, is essentially impossible. There are misguided teenagers out there right now creating cyber weapons. I can tell you this because 50 years ago, I was one of them. I was in the business of creating cyber weapons. It wasn't illegal then, which is an interesting point, or at least using them wasn't illegal then. And so there are lots of people out there creating cyber weapons right now as we speak. Questions about use, governing the use of cyber weapons? Well, that's an interesting question. There are right now no agreements constraining the use of cyber weapons, except to the extent that nations agree that cyber weapons are governed by the laws of war. Okay? So if you use the cyber weapons in a way that causes, you know, in an armed conflict that causes damage in certain ways, and those ways are prohibited by the laws of war, that they would be constrained too. But there is not agreement among the nations of the world that the laws of war apply to cyberspace. And then there's norms of behavior and so on, which you can imagine. They are things like nations will agree to cooperate with each other in suppressing criminal use of cyber weapons and so on. And that means both nations have to, two nations who are going to cooperate have to agree that a certain use of cyber weapon is a bad thing and to criminalize it. And so there are some emerging agreements like that, but they are not binding except to the extent that each nation individually says, I will pass a law that will make this particular use illegal. From my standpoint, there are four things to consider when you think about governing the governance of cyber weapons. One is that the technology base is ubiquitous, it really is everywhere. Second is that I think that we've seen that they're just too useful to give up as an instrument of national power and influence. It's not just in the web. Not just remember, it's not just destroying things. It's used for spying too, and the spying part is really, really, really important. Intelligence agencies all over the world, of every country, spy on everybody else, and cyber is just one other way of doing that. And the third point is that there's no clear threshold because of this infinite scalability argument. That there's no, you know, if a nuclear weapon goes off, you know it. Okay, a 50-ton yield, which is trivial compared to most nuclear weapons, 50-ton yield, everybody will notice that. Everyone will know that, and that's a real threshold event. No such threshold for cyber. And the last point is that there are, of course, many paths to expertise. It's not stuff, the expertise here is not confined to the laboratory or to PhDs or even to master's degree students or even to anybody with any degree at all. It just happens. And getting a handle on that is going to be very tough. So there's a long road ahead for controlling, for getting a good handle on the governance of cyber weapons. From my standpoint, probably, and this isn't part of my paper, but I'll say that probably the most important step would be for us as a nation to decide whether we're better off in a world in which everybody is penetrable or everybody is defendable. And until we get our handle on that, we're going to be talking out of both sides of our mouths. Now, you know, nations are hypocritical. That's okay. I mean, they have contradictory goals. But that's sort of the reality as I see it there.